Okay, welcome everybody. A bit about my background. My background is in software engineering, and I'm a software engineering lecturer at Fontys since 2012. But a few years ago, I also started to get involved in our specialization, which is called Applied Data Science. And today I'm giving a talk about applied data science, machine learning, but from the perspective of me as a software engineer. Since February last year, I also started a research project specifically aimed at that. As you can see, my background in software engineering is also more focused on the quality of software applications. So now I'm also interested in the quality of machine learning applications. So that will be also the topic of my talk today. A bit about definitions. If I speak about machine learning, I also include deep learning. So for me, deep learning is a subset of machine learning algorithms. And as you can see, AI, machine learning is basically the set of algorithms to build AI applications. That's the knowledge that we have until now. We have a set of algorithms that allow us to build some form of artificial intelligence. As we heard Gerard say, it's mostly perception, but okay, we can do this, and how to do this in a proper way. Who is not familiar with machine learning? What it is? Definitions? Okay. There are some people, so a quick recap then. So machine learning is learning from data. We also heard it from Gerard. We have to feed machine learning algorithms with a lot of data, with examples, and they will learn from it. But okay, what does it actually mean, learning from data? I have a really small example. Oh, that's supposed to be... Oh yeah, okay, no. I have a small example. Now let's take this example. Let's say this is the data that we have, and we want to learn from it if a person is obese or not obese. So we have some examples. We have, in this case, it's a small example. So we have four people from which we know the length and the height and if they are male or female and if they are obese or not. And now we would like to predict for the last two persons if they are obese or not. Any observations? Obese? Not obese?
Yes, I know.
Yes, I know.
Male, female.
Let's see the answer. And of course, I assume most of you know this. There is actually a rule, an algorithm, a calculation that doctors use to calculate this, if a person is obese or not. And if we calculate it for the last two persons, we see that both of them are obese. But we also saw that for you as a human, it was quite difficult to see only from the examples, if the last two persons would be obese or not, because their length and height are a bit in between the other examples, so we don't know how this will calculate. But this is actually an example where we know the rules. So for us as software engineers, as programmers, if we know the rules, then it's better to program them ourselves. We program them and we are exactly sure that our program will always behave in the same way, and that it always will behave according to this algorithm that is shown here below. But there are a lot of cases where we don't know the rules. And if we don't know the rules, we cannot program them ourselves, then it would be a good idea to look into machine learning, deep learning, and artificial intelligence. So just this is to give an overview of what I was talking about on the previous slide in a picture. In classical, what I call rule-based programming, the programmer is provided with rules and some data, usually in a database. There will be some classical programming, and then we can provide answers. But in a machine learning world, we are provided with data. This was an example I showed before, was the length and the height and the person ID and the sex of the person, and the gender of the person. And answers, for some of them we knew if they are obese or not. And somehow this machine learning algorithm is learning the rules from the data. So we're not programming the rules ourselves, we are learning them from the example data. But of course, this is only part of the picture for machine learning, because if we have the rules, then we still have to do something with it, because we are eventually we're looking for answers, right? But we put some answers in, so we're looking for answers for new data. And that is what this picture is showing. So this is also something you need to keep in mind if you do machine learning applications. You always have two phases, actually. You have a first phase where you have to train an algorithm to learn the rules from the data. And then you have the second phase where you input new data into this learned algorithm, trained algorithm. That's the phase that we call inference. This is a terminology from machine learning application domain, where you put some new data into this trained model and you get the answers. So you need this two-step process. This is specific for machine learning applications. We don't have this in software engineering because we program the rules ourselves, so we immediately have the answers. But this is a two-step thing. For your information, we do this type of training applications. We do that with, Gerard also mentioned it, JuPython notebooks, Python, TensorFlow, Keras for deep learning. So this is a specific set of programming tools for training machine learning models. And then you also have to program something, you have to engineer a kind of end-user application where you provide answers for new data to the end-user. So these are two specific phases that you need in each machine learning project, where you have something that you do. This is basically what we call applied data science or data science. And there is the part what we call engineering machine learning applications. So you have to engineer an end user application that can provide answers to end users. If you have such a project where you have to engineer a machine learning application, it's called engineering. So we are following an engineering life cycle. So somehow we have to analyze requirements, come up with a design, implement the application, test it, and evolve it. But for data science, the first part of the previous picture, there's also an approach where you have to engineer your data. You have to collect the correct data. You have to collect the right examples to train your machine learning model. So there's a huge part of data preparation. There's the modeling part. And there's also a kind of testing evaluation part for your model. So these are the engineering cycles that you need in your machine learning project. So you already see a bit of the complexity of that type of project. This is a pointer. I think the slides will be available also afterwards. A pointer to a blog I wrote about why engineering machine learning projects is so different from traditional software engineering. So here you can find the full description of that. But for the talk today, because the theme of the conference is In Bots We Trust, I will focus on the testing part of the machine learning project. And there's a very good survey that I found. It's called Machine Learning Testing Survey Landscapes and Horizons. It's an academic survey, but it gives some very good insights into why testing machine learning applications is so difficult or complex or different in this case from traditional testing. And I don't want you to get all of the details. You can get that from the paper if you want. But something that you can already see on the left-hand side, if you test machine learning applications, you also are testing the data. Because you can imagine if you give your machine learning algorithm wrong examples, it will learn wrong rules. So testing your data is a really important part of machine learning projects. And the same survey also has a nice overview of the testing setup, the testing workflow that you need for machine learning projects. And again, I don't want to go into all the details. Important thing that you should notice is this part. We have the offline testing, and that's kind of testing that we also know for software engineering projects. But we have to know that we are never ready. The testing is never finished after we go online. So in this part of the project, we are feeding the model with new data. So this can be data that we didn't see before, that we didn't test the model against. So we have to keep monitoring our model also in, let's say, in production, in online, because we have to be aware that the model can start behaving really in a strange and unexpected way because we are feeding new data. So of course, the better our testing is in this phase, if we have good data examples, we can be more sure that the model will not misbehave in practice, but we can never be completely sure. Then from the same survey, there's also a nice overview of what kind of properties we are testing for machine learning applications. And today, I will focus also a bit in line with what Gerard was saying on the interpretability property. Gerard was saying, okay, we need models that can be explainable AI, that we can explain to people why the model is making decision A or decision B. But for us, it's also important from an engineering perspective. This kind of behavior is also important because we need it for debugging. Suppose we have a model and we know this answer is wrong or unexpected, then as an engineer we need to know why does this unexpected answer come. Is there an error in the data? Is there an error in the model? Is there something else going wrong? So interpretability is important for end users, but also for us as engineers. And I did some research in the past months about tools that engineers could use to work on the interpretability of their machine learning applications. And this is a quick overview. I put it here so those of you who are interested in it can look it up later and see what's in there. I pointed this one out because here is a list of open source libraries, not only for the testing part of your machine learning applications, but for the complete, all the things that you need to put your machine learning application into production. So today I'm focusing on this part, explaining predictions and models, but there is much more. So for each of the aspects of a full production application, there's already a lot of support and tools and libraries out there that you can use as an engineer. And for example, this one, the second one is also a really quick tutorial, including Python code to make your model explainable, interpretable. So if you want to start somewhere, if you're really new into this topic and you think, okay, I'll take a look at it, I would suggest you start at the second one because it will give you some ideas about why interpretability is important and how you can use it as a software engineer. This I wanted to show you because it's a nice project that one of our graduation students did at one of the organizations that we cooperate with. So it was a student for ICT and software engineering, and he went to an organization and he made for them this interpretability dashboard. So the idea is this dashboard shows for one given machine learning model some interpretability scores. So the student could make this by using all the tools that I just showed you. There are some lists to find out there. The student could integrate all of these kind of tools that say something about the interpretability of a machine learning model. He integrated that into a nice dashboard and he could help the organization improve the interpretability of their machine learning models. It's just to show you that it's something, yeah, it's out there, it's open source, and our students are able to make something practical out of it. So it means that all of you could also do that if you want to do it. So in Bots We Trust, back to the theme of today's conference, engineering machine learning applications. What should you do, at least, because I just started my research, and like Gerard said, every day there's new publications and new tools coming out. But for now, at least you should start, do this testing workflow specifically for machine learning applications. So it's the offline testing and the online testing. You should work on collecting a good set of examples where you train your models on. And there is a technique called cross-validation that's really common in applied data science, where you say, okay, I'm not training my model on my complete data set, but I take out part of my data set that I will use later to verify if my model is behaving correctly. So that you need to do in the testing data part. You should use all these tools that I just collected for making your models more interpretable. You should do that as a good software engineer, a good machine learning engineer. You should do that by design. Include all of these interpretability metrics into your model. And for me, last but not least, and this is something that you already learned from software testing, if you want to make a machine learning application that's trustworthy, that can be trusted, you need to involve for sure the domain experts, because they are the ones that can tell you, is this answer unexpected, or what do I see in the data, what's going on in production. For sure the domain experts, but probably, and this is where my next year of research will also focus on, probably you will also need to include a lot more disciplines to make really trustworthy machine learning applications. And that's what I will do for the... I now spend 1 year for my research project. I'll spend another year collecting more case studies, so really examples of projects that our students do in applied data science and in the engineering of machine learning applications. Hopefully after 1 year I will have a toolbox. I showed you some examples for testing, but there are many more areas in machine learning applications where I can collect tools and best practices to present, first of all, to our students, but second of all, to the ICT organizations in the Netherlands and also in other places. So if you are somehow interested in this topic, please contact me. We can see how we can work together to continue this line of research. So thank you.